Matthew McCabe. Welcome to Miracle Voices. Each episode, we will be delving into stories of forgiveness, healing, and transformation that have come about from integrating the principles of the book, A Course in Miracles. If you want to learn more about A Course in Miracles, visit www.acim.org. If you'd like to visit the Miracle Voices site, please go to www.miraclevoices.org. If you feel inspired to make a love offering, please visit us at miraclevoices.org/donate. All donations go to support the work of the Foundation for Inner Peace, the publisher of A Course in Miracles. Now here's your program. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another edition of Miracle Voices. This is your co-host, Matt McCabe, and I'm here with my co-host, Tam Morgan. Tam, how are you doing?
I am doing great today. How are you doing?
Very well, thank you. I'm super excited for our returning guest, Keith Kavanagh. Keith, welcome back.
Repeat. Thank you very much.
We love a repeat performance.
Yes. Thanks for having me back.
Keith, your community on Facebook continues to grow. Now you have a website. You have the podcast. It's all going swimmingly. Just give us a mini update on you, the lessons you've been on.
Yeah, it's all kind of, for someone who never had any interest in teaching A Course in Miracles, it all kind of just happened by itself and snowballed. So yes, yeah.
Tell me about it, Pete. Tell me about it.
So yeah, we do. We have about 4,500 members in the Facebook group now. And we have a podcast up and running, which we update weekly. And yeah, I started a website eventually, and I've started doing some private coaching for people as well, just so they can have an experience of what it is to not be the body, not be the person, and be above the battlegrounds. So that's kind of where we're at.
Well, that's not much. What else are you going to do?
Yeah. Clone himself. Yeah. And I'll put all that in the show notes too, for people who are interested in learning more about it.
Great. I'd like to know what you do for a vacation.
For vacation, I'm going to Brazil actually in 2 weeks to visit the in-laws. So that's the next vacation.
Nice. That's quite a stark contrast from Ireland to go to Brazil.
Yeah, it'll be nice to get some sun. Yeah. It'll break the winter up a little.
Oh, that's nice. Well, Keith, let's jump right into it. This is a different, since we kind of got your backstory last time, and I'll include in the show notes your original interview on Miracle Voices, but we're gonna do a little bit more freestyle format today. Before we jump into it, can you just review the forgiveness process for us so we can kind of start with a stable foundation?
Yeah, sure. So Jesus is preparing us in the workbook and explaining to us in the text that there is a way of looking on suffering so it disappears. So I love this particular quote, if you'll bear with me. Sure. This is from chapter 14. Verse 2, section 6, and it's the Holy Spirit asks of you but this: bring him every secret you have locked away from him, open every door to him, and bid him enter the darkness and lighten it away. At your request, he enters gladly. He brings the light to darkness if you make the darkness open to him, but what you hide, he cannot look upon. He sees for you, and unless you look with him, he cannot see. The vision of Christ is not for him alone, but for him with you. Bring therefore all your dark and secret thoughts to him and look upon them with him. He holds the light and you the darkness. Now here's the real clincher. They cannot coexist when both of you together look upon them. His judgment must prevail, and he will give it to you as you join your perception to his. So that's the great promise of Jesus in the Course. He's saying, you look at your suffering, you know, with your favorite symbol, me, the Holy Spirit, you look on it and it disappears. So that's what forgiveness is. Forgiveness is looking on suffering so it vanishes.
Yeah.
So I'm going to jump in just for a second.
Here that
I've been asked. Why can the all-seeing not see one's darkness without giving it to him?
Sorry, Tom, just say that again.
Sorry. Why can Jesus, who can be all seeing, not see our darkness unless we choose to show it?
Because at the ultimate level, That's a very deep question.
Let me try
and do a backstory here, okay? So at the moment that the separation appeared to happen, it has never happened, right? It seemed like Christ... it seemed like Christ separated from God, and Christ as a oneness joined as one, the beingness of heaven. It seemed like it happened. And in that instant, consciousness split into the ego, which was like, there's a me here, there's a God there, I have separated, I have destroyed oneness. And then there was the Holy Spirit, which was the memory of oneness, which means there might be appearances of a separation, but it can't possibly be true. It simply isn't true. It's still only God and Christ as one. So that's what happened, apparently. Now, that's all that's going on now. That is all that's going on now. That moment, okay, of choice between is separation real or is it impossible? And so the Holy Spirit is just this, you know, the Holy Spirit looked on error and did nothing with it. The Holy Spirit did not make it real. It was like there might be an appearance of separateness, but it simply isn't true because there is the oneness here. There is just this light shining, which is God and Christ as one. The one is joined as one. And so what we're looking on simply cannot be. And so at the highest level, you are the Holy Spirit. There is no Tam. So this whole world was just one big smokescreen that was thrown up to disguise that one choice. Is separateness a thing or is it not? And so at the highest level, you know, Jesus says the ego is legion, but the Holy Spirit is one. There are 8 billion wrong minds on the world, but they're just appearances. They're not real. And there is just one Holy Spirit. So, you know, we each have a wrong mind and we have a right mind, but there's just one right mind. Above the battleground with Jesus, experiencing ourselves as non-judgmental awareness, there's just one of us. Yeah. And that's the extension of the Holy Spirit. That's the end of separateness. That's the holy instant.
Now, I have a similar answer, but a little bit more in the world of form. Mm-hmm. I've been thinking about it. But I would still say, but interesting, suddenly, if you bring it to Holy Spirit, it can then see it and, you know, and then work to bring the light to it. And my interpretation, and I am not a course teacher. I will never say I'm a course teacher. I hope, I don't think I will, but is that whole point of a little willingness. There's something in the relationship, even though we don't have, ultimately, we're in the dream and our ego is not even real. There is something in the world of form for the ego to have a choice to even let go of itself. And it just seems like there's a dynamic in there when one brings one's deepest, darkest secret that it thinks it's holding to the light, where it becomes part of the joke that it was never a secret. And that's part of the healing in itself. And it's never been dark. The ego just believed it was dark. And I don't know exactly how the Course really handles that, but that's how I perceived it to make it comprehensive to me.
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, the apparent part that split from God and Christ as a oneness joined as one, one beingness, one will, the part that apparently split was consciousness, and consciousness split again. And ultimately, the little willingness is that if you look at the error, it will vanish. You don't have to fight the error. You don't have to change the error. You don't have to suffocate the error. You don't have to beat yourself around the head with the Course. All you have to do is join your perception to the Holy Spirit and look at the error, and it will disappear. Yeah. So to me, that's the little willingness. You don't fight the darkness. You don't try and stop the darkness. You don't try and fix the darkness. You do nothing. Jesus is quite clear that you don't do forgiveness. You simply bring it to the Holy Spirit. And that means you bring the error to non-judgmental awareness, and it vanishes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So to me, that's the little willingness. Because actually, Jesus doesn't want a lot of willingness. He's like, no, don't do too much. Don't try and fight your darkness. Don't try and fight your hatred. Don't try and get rid of this. Don't do nothing. You know, he's quite clear. He's saying that's the Holy Spirit's job. That's not yours. Do not try and remove your anger before you bring it. That's what the holy instant is for. And so he's really saying, look, I'm asking you for the smallest thing. I'm asking you, will you come and join with the Holy Spirit? And will you look on the error with no judgment? That's the little willingness. He's saying, don't fight it. Do nothing. Listen, all you have to do is look at it with no judgment. Now, the beauty of that is that the ego can do nothing with no judgment. The ego right. is nothing but judgment and opinion and labeling. And the minute you look at anything without judgment, you're not in canvas Kansas anymore. You, consciousness, are no longer identified with the ego. You are identified with the Holy Spirit as a non-judgmental awareness. And that awareness is not a person. Previously, thoughts and feelings were happening, and you thought you were the person thinking them and feeling them. But now you, consciousness, have undone identification as the thinker and the feeler, and you have become awareness. And the awareness of fear and pain and upset is not afraid, is not upset. It is the quiet center. It is the stately calm. It is the changeless dwelling place. The minute we look at the ego without judgment, we experience what we are. That's not the ego. That's not separate. That is a non-judgmental awareness, which is already whole and complete and wants for nothing.
Then who is bringing the darkness to Holy Spirit?
In truth, there is no darkness.
Right. So that's okay. Where it gets so complicated and tricky, because for me, when I bring my darkness to that awareness within that forgiveness as it disappears, it actually, in the world of form, feels like it's my ego going, I don't want to do this, but I'm gonna, because I don't want to suffer. Mm-hmm. And so it seems to be an interaction with the ego going, okay, I'll bring my darkness or yeah. No, I don't want to yet. And it's self-annihilating within the ego to actually do that, but the ego is experiencing or thinking it's experiencing suffering. So it gets tricked a little bit to doing it.
And I don't think it matters too much what way you understand it. Jesus even says in the clarification of terms, he says, look, I'm not interested in this specificity of terms and this precision with terms. He says, I'm not interested in that because, you know, the whole mind there, the consciousness, which has an ego and a decision-making element and Holy Spirit, he's saying it doesn't even exist.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's not even fussy how you understand the process. Now, I would suggest that you understand that consciousness is the decision maker because it's split. It can be wrong-minded or right-minded. And if it's wrong-minded, it thinks it's a person. It thinks it's a thinker of thoughts and it thinks it's a feeler of feelings. And if it's right-minded, it's a non-judgmental awareness of thoughts and feelings happening, the ego's thoughts and feelings, but it's not claiming them as his, as its.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I would say that's a nice, neat way of understanding it. Consciousness is the mind that's split. It's the apparently separated Son of God, which, of course, doesn't even exist. But it's where we're at, and we got to work with where we're at. And consciousness can choose separateness as its thought system and will think it's a separate self, or it can choose to fall back and be a non-judgmental awareness of thoughts and feelings and stories happening without being what the thoughts and feelings and stories are about, or who's having them.
Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Thank you. And bringing up these questions because they have been asked consistently
sure.
here and there. And I want our audience to get to hear your explanation of that. But can I go rogue for a second, Matt?
Sure.
Okay. I'm going rogue just because. Do you have jury duty where you live? Is there jury duty?
In Ireland?
There is jury duty. I haven't done jury duty yet.
Okay. So this is my question. If you're called to jury duty and you are asked, you know, you have to say whether someone's guilty or not, would you be able to, within your practice, show up in the world of form to have someone be accountable and whatever that means for some actions that seem to be in the world of guilt? Would it be a way of looking at it saying, well, there's still things that this person might need to have on their journey to going to prison? Or like, what would be your stance about that civic obligation? I'm asking because I have to report to jury duty next week. I'm struggling with this. I really am. I can just see the look on the judge's face. It's like, I can't condemn anyone to being guilty. My practice really is not that. And yet I believe in the system to help, you know, to help some type of, you know, I can't even pick up the word at the moment, but accountability for action in a certain way. And I am struggling with this. So I am asking you this question.
Yeah. Let's take a couple of quotes. Let's go to lesson 93. The self you made is not the Son of God. Therefore, this self does not exist at all. And anything it seems to do and think means nothing. It is neither bad nor good. It is unreal and nothing more than that. It does not battle with the Son of God, that's you. It does not hurt him nor attack his peace, that's yours. It has not changed creation nor reduced eternal sinlessness to sin and love to hate. What power can this self you made possess when it would contradict the will of God? So Jesus is saying, okay, you think you're a separate self and you think it matters what you think and what you do and what you understand. And he's going, actually, do you know something? That just doesn't even exist. He's saying the truth, the right-minded identity I want you to understand is that you are present moment awareness and you are not defined by a past or by any story or label. You are a pure present moment awareness. That's what you are. That's the truth of you. So just to take another quote from the course, this is from the text, chapter 7, verse 8. When you heal, that is exactly what you are learning. You are recognizing the changeless mind in your brother by realizing that he could not have changed his mind. This is how you perceive the Holy Spirit in him, which is that awareness, that non-judgmental awareness. It is only the Holy Spirit in him that never changes his mind. Okay, so the thing is, it really isn't any of our business what someone's journey is and what's best for them. Jesus is quite clear that correction is not our concern. Instead, what we have to do is we have to fix our own vision. So what we're doing is, you know, we are looking at a brother and we're saying, well, he's a body and he's what the body did and he's what his ego did. And Jesus is quite clear. He's saying, listen, that self doesn't exist. Anything it seems to be doing and thinking means nothing. So we come to workbook lesson number one, which says nothing I see means anything at all. I'm seeing a body. I'm, you know, seeing a report of a story of what that body did, and I'm hearing a report of what that body said. And Jesus is going, that's not your brother. That's an appearance. And it means absolutely nothing.
So would you show up for jury duty?
I would. But you see, we can't mistake form and content. Okay. So at the content level, there's no such thing as an ego. There's no such thing as a separate self. That's what Jesus is saying there. Only the part of your brother that's changeless is what's true. And that's what all you're supposed to be seeing. Okay. Now, you know, ultimately, in terms of what the body did and what the body has to be punished with and society kept safe and the body rehabilitated, that's all going to happen. That's all going to apparently happen in the dream, but that's got nothing to do with what your brother is. So our only job is to see the truth of the brother, and it's to understand I am not a body. I am not the insane voice talking to itself in my mind. Nothing I think I've ever done or said means anything at all. And that's the truth of my brother. So there's a decision getting made in the dream about what a body did and what's going to happen to a body. But all you have to do is be really clear that we're not talking about your brother.
And yet, when you're asked to come up with a verdict of innocent or guilty.
Yeah, it's something you're asked to do about a body, but your brother's not a body. So in your mind, you just need to be really clear that your brother is not what the body did. So you do you fulfill a role within the dream, but you just don't make a big deal out of it or take it seriously.
Okay. Love the answer.
So if you identify with the stillness, the peace that is you, present moment awareness and the Holy Spirit in this moment, well then, you know, right-minded thinking and deciding and doing will translate itself from the peace and the stillness and the wholeness that's there. And that will just be the Holy Spirit's script. And it'll be whatever is the most helpful and loving and effective thing to do in the situation for everyone concerned, whether it's the victim, the apparent victor, the victim, the apparent perpetrator, for you, for the judge, for society. I mean, that's just going to take care of itself. But again, you're not going to be able to have that right-minded decision take place unless you understand that you're not a body and you're nothing that the body ever did, and that you are not any of the thoughts in your mind. You are the stillness. You are the quiet center, and so is your brother. And it's only from that that right-minded action can happen.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like yeah. using these real life examples to...
This is like an ethics course, I feel like.
Okay, I'm backing off, Matt. Go for it.
No, I was thinking, you know, back to your jury duty example, it's like Holy Spirit's, like the movie The Matrix, Holy Spirit's Morpheus, and then there's Neo, who's Tam, and they both jump in the chair, they hook up their brain and their spinal cord, and they say, we're going into the Matrix. And when we get in, Morpheus is like, hey, we're in the Matrix. And Neo's like, no, this is real. We're in a courtroom, and I have to make it up. So he's like, remember, we're back. We're back on the spaceship. We think we're here. And is that what, that's what you're kind of getting at, is like, this is not real. This is code. It's not real. And so that awareness that you're talking about, Keith, recently on one of your podcasts, you mentioned, I need do nothing. And that was one that always frustrated me. It frustrates a lot of people because it's like, wait a minute here. It's like, I feel like I'm informed. I'm making 1,000 decisions a day, most of them ego guided. What does that mean? And then you explain it really well on your podcast about once you realize that you're the awareness watching Matt, you realize that Matt's going to do all these things and the awareness need do nothing. The I need do nothing is the awareness need do nothing, not this. You know, this hamster in the maze that I'm watching, that hamster is going to continue to do stuff. It's the awareness won't. The awareness is just doing nothing, watching it all happen.
Yeah. I for my last podcast, I was all prepared to give a Halloween theme because it's Halloween. We're coming up to Halloween weekend this weekend. And so I had to change my theme at the last minute when I went, oh my God, it's not Halloween yet. So anyway, this is going to be my Halloween podcast episode. So here's my metaphor.
Okay.
With a Halloween twist, which I think explains this really well.
Trick or treat. Go for it.
Let me see if I can dig out a quick quote here, which is kind of important. Okay, this is from lesson 25. And this is incredibly important. You perceive the world and everything in it as meaningful in terms of ego goals. These goals have nothing to do with your own best interests because the ego is not you. This false identification makes you incapable of understanding what anything is for. So what Jesus is saying is you think you have goals and fears and wants and things that are important, and it's got nothing to do with you because the ego is not you. You're not a separate self. So here's my metaphor. It's Halloween. I'm going to dress up for Halloween, and I've decided I'm going to be Dracula. I am going to be a vampire. I'm going to put the cape on. I'm going to get the fangs. I'm going to grease my hair back and dye it black. I'm going to put the white paint on my face. I'm sorted. I'm dressed up as a vampire. And then I start thinking I am a vampire. Now, the minute I do that, a very specific set of lacks and needs and wants arise. Instantly, I feel vulnerable. I feel like I need to survive as a vampire. And to do that, I'm going to have to contact an undertaker and get a coffin. I'm going to have to get that delivered and try and keep it secret. I need to get some soil transported from Transylvania, and I need to line the coffin with the Transylvanian soil, and I need to find a creepy church that's been, you know, consecrated so that I can rest in the crypt of that creepy church during the daytime. And now I also find that there is a very specific set of problems and phobias that have arisen from myself. I now have a mortal terror and a phobic response to holy water, to crucifixes, and to daylight and garlic. And so now I'm going to set about all these goals and problems that I have, and I'm going to try and fix them as a vampire.
The worst is the garlic, I have to tell you, because I haven't.
So that is the condition in which we think we are. We're running around thinking we're vampires, and we are going around trying to fix the problems of a vampire, fix the fears of a vampire, and satisfy the needs of a vampire. And Jesus comes in the course, and specifically in that text, and he's going, listen, your problem is not that you need a coffin. Your problem is not that you need Transylvanian soil. Your problem is not that you have a fear of holy water, crosses, crucifixes, and garlic. Your problem is not trying to keep secret the delivery of all these things and find a therapist that won't judge you for being a vampire. None of that is your problem. He's saying you've got one problem, and there's one solution to every problem you think you have, because it's all the same problem. You're not a vampire. And that's what he's saying to us in this text. He's saying, listen, all those goals and fears and wants and problems that you think you have are meaningless. He's saying there's one problem. You think you're separate. You think you're a body. You think you are the insane voice talking to itself in your mind. And that is the only problem you have.
And that's the trick and the treat. It is, we're not that, and the trick that we think we are.
Yeah.
That's why I love Halloween so much.
Yeah. So he's saying you don't have millions of problems. You have one, and it's that you think you're something you're not. And he's saying all you have to do is undo the mistaken identification with what you're not, and you will experience what you are in the Holy Spirit as a non-judgmental awareness that is whole, that is complete, that needs nothing, that needs do nothing, that is already whole in the Holy Spirit. There is no lack in the Holy Spirit. And he's saying, don't stay a vampire and go looking for awareness. Don't stay a vampire and go looking for the Holy Spirit. You know, don't stay the separate self and go looking for a Holy Spirit. That's nonsense. He's saying what you have to do is you have to undo your mistaken identification as separate. And in that, you will experience what you are. That is non-judgmental, present moment awareness in the Holy Spirit that needs do nothing.
Yeah.
Love the example. Thank you.
Yeah.
A lot of people know what this awareness feels like, Keith, and there's a lot that don't. Mm-hmm. How do you kind of nudge people or help them kind of get into that awareness feeling so they know what you're talking about? I want to feel this awareness. I don't know what he's talking about, but it sounds
absolutely
great.
Yeah, because you see, everyone looks for it as an object, and it's not an object. Everyone is like, how do I, the separate self, experience awareness? And that's not possible. So you have to undo your mistaken identification as what's separate. And so here's the trick, right? What's going on is a three-ring circus, right? And there is thoughts that are, Jesus tells us, are not your real thoughts. You know, the reason the idea for today's lesson applies to all your thoughts equally is because none of them are your real thoughts. So he's saying, so in this three-ring circus, you have all the thoughts that are going on, which are the vampire's thoughts, not yours. And then you have feelings that are going on. And again, these are the ego's feelings. They're not yours. And then there are the stories that's getting spun about happenings and feelings and stories and all the rest of it, okay? And that is the condition, let's say, that most of the world finds themselves in, which is thinking they are the circus. Yeah. Now, then we encounter a spiritual philosophy like A Course in Miracles. And now what we do is we identify as the ringmaster of the circus. And now what we're trying to do is we're trying to tame the circus, and we're trying to make it a better circus. And we're trying to make it a holy circus, and we're trying to fix it and understand it and get it right. And the understanding is the ringmaster is still part of the circus. And so what we have to do when Jesus says, you know, they cannot coexist when you join your perception to his perception is what happened at the apparent beginning, which is that he looked at the ego and didn't take it seriously. He did nothing. He didn't resist it. He didn't try and fix it. He didn't try and change it. He did nothing with it because it's nothing. He allowed the illusion to be and knew it was harmless. That's the Holy Spirit's perspective. So for us, because that is the ego mind, which is all of the stories and the thoughts and the feelings, the tree ring circus, and there's the ringmaster in there trying to get it together and sort it out. And what Jesus is saying is, you're not any of that. You're not in the circus. And so he's saying is, come out of all of that to where I am, to what the Holy Spirit is. And the way we do that is we let go of all resistance to the circus. The only way for us to join our perception to the Holy Spirit's is through radical allowing of the whole three ring circus, allowing it to be exactly what it is, welcoming exactly what it is, a complete non-interference, a complete non-judgment, a complete allowing. And in the allowing of thoughts, feelings, and stories, and trying to work it out and trying to fix it, and just letting it be what it is, there's a peace rises in your mind. And it's the peace that's now aware of the non-peace. And that's step one. And then step two is understanding you are the peace. You are not the three ring circus and you're not the ringmaster. You are this peace that has arisen. And as you make your stand as this peace, as this stillness, as this allowing, the circus can't stand. Because the circus, all of the pain and the hurt and the loss and the stories have got nothing to do with what you are as non-judgmental awareness and the Holy Spirit. It all has to do with you thinking you're a vampire. It all has to do with you thinking you are a separate self. And the minute you identify as the stillness, the peace, the allowing, instead of the noise and the pain and the upset, the minute you identify as what is aware of the mess, but not the mess, the mess can't stand.
Right. The mess can't stand. The circus still perhaps can stand, but you're in it like a child who's so excited to be in that costume. And like, even let's step away from vampire, which, you know, with all its negative connotations, to a pretty princess, you know, and you get so excited to be the pretty princess and you don't want to give up the pretty princess because it seems so pretty until there's suffering involved, until it brings you into, wait a second, why does the pretty princess have responsibilities? Why does the pretty princess have to only wear this and not that and can't play pauper? And when you wake up in this dream with that sense of peace, the dream itself doesn't necessarily go away, but your enjoyment of being in it and watching it and being non-attached to it is what blossoms.
Yeah, this quote, I'm not sure if I can remember it exactly properly, but the gist of it is Jesus says, how else can you find hope in a hopeless place except by realizing you're not there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so that's what we're supposed to be realizing in the course. We're learning to go above the battleground, which means we leave the battleground of bodies, where we stop identifying as a body and a separate self, and we identify as this stillness and peace in our mind. And when you identify as that, you now see that as the truth of everyone and everything. And that's Christ's vision.
Yes, but as you're still here.
No.
You're never here.
You're never here. You're never in the projection. No matter how much you might think you are, you are never in the circus. It's an illusion. Because there is never anything to our identity other than awareness. There's no such thing as a person. There's no such thing as a separate self. There is either awareness aware of itself and its wholeness and completeness in the present moment, and it's always the present moment, or there is awareness apparently unaware of itself, identified with the ego's thoughts, feelings, and stories. And that's all a person is. There is no such thing as a separate self whatsoever. Never at any point in time is there a separate self. It is always made up out of stories.
Mm-hmm.
So if we take a quote on that, let me dig one out here quickly.
I want you to insert in here, if you wouldn't mind, find your quote. Your understanding of the happy dream.
And that is the happy dream.
Exactly.
Don't worry about my quote. Someone remind me what the question was, because I got derailed.
Sorry, I'm good at that.
Well, Keith, I know that there's a lot of people listening, because I went through this myself, and you're like, I hear what you're saying, understand it. But I still have resistance. And I think you talk about this quote I just put up here on the screen that you can see in Zoom. I was wondering if you could read that and just discuss that a little bit.
Okay. Let's have a look. Yes. Okay. I will come to that. But the quote I was looking for, I have found it here, which is really important. Whatever form temptation seems to take, it always but reflects a wish to be a self that you are not. And from that wish, a concept arises, teaching you that you are the thing you wish to be. It will remain your concept of yourself until the wish that fathered it is no longer held dear. So Jesus is quite clearly saying to us here, listen, you have two apparent selves. Now, he's also quite clear that we're not two selves battling with each other. And and that's because there's no such thing as a separate self, right? All you ever are is a present moment, non-judgmental awareness and the Holy Spirit. The decision maker joined with the Holy Spirit is a non-judgmental observer of the ego. So that was the quote I wanted to look at there, which is a really important one. At no point in time is there a separate self. You can identify, it's only made out of stories. You know, Jesus says in the Course that the body is never actually here at all. It's always only ever remembered or anticipated. And whenever Jesus says body in the Course, he means the physical body and the psychological body. That's what he means by that. You're not the figure in the dream. You're not the body in the world. And so if we apply that similarly, if you look for evidence of you, the separate self in the present moment, without recourse to a past and without fantasies about a future, there is absolutely no separate self there in the present moment. If you go looking for a separate self in this present moment without a past that never happened and a future that will never come, in this moment, there is no evidence of a separate self. All you will find is the present moment awareness that you are. And that's our right-minded identity. So either we know what we are as a present moment awareness, or we have overlooked that in order to take on an illusory self-imposed limitation of ourselves, a separate self made out of stories from the past and fantasies of the future. And the minute we do that, suffering arises. There is a terrible lack and self-hatred and inadequacy. And from that, this thinking I am a thing that I am not, this separate self, comes all of the vampire's needs, which have got nothing to do with your needs because you have none. Present moment awareness is already whole and complete and needs do nothing. So there's never a separate self. There is only present moment awareness in the Holy Spirit. And there's just one Holy Spirit. There's just one awareness. This is above the battleground where what you are, everyone and everything is. And there are appearances, there's the appearances of a world, there's the appearances of happenings, there's the appearances of thoughts, and they're just appearances. All of it is wholeness and completeness and holiness only appearing as things that holiness and wholeness can't be. And as that's why Jesus says, nothing I see means anything at all. The appearances mean absolutely nothing. Because everything is made out of the one consciousness, which is wholly seen from the Holy Spirit. Because it's consciousness, the Holy Spirit and consciousness, as the memory of God in Christ as one. And that's what's seen, and that's what's Christ's vision. It doesn't matter what I'm looking at. It means absolutely nothing because it's just an appearance. It is wholeness. It is holiness. It is completeness, just apparently appearing as war and suffering and famine. And they're just appearances because only love is real. It's like your favorite quote, Matt, where you say, when you want only love, that is all you'll see. Right. Everything is love, only appearing as things that are not love, but they don't mean anything and there's no point to them because it's all still love. And that's Christ's vision. And that's the collapse of separateness. That is the oneness in the Holy Spirit.
Makes a lot of sense, but this dissociative amnesia is so powerful that I'm like, I'm totally soaring on this plane with Keith right now. And I stub my toe and damn it, what? You know, it's like I'm out of it, like snapped out, and I'm a body and I've got to, you know, make dinner and, you know, all these things come in.
At no point in time are you a body. So try this one, Matt, right? Okay. So again, are you the body or are you the awareness of the body?
The awareness.
Okay. And are you in the body or is the body in you?
The body's in me.
Isn't it? Is that your experience?
Yeah. I mean, I feel like the body's in my awareness. I'm seeing it.
It's in the field of the awareness that you are. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So you're not a body. Is there any evidence that the body is you apart from the thought that says, I am a body?
Thoughts and senses, yes, which is, I guess, another thought, the sensations.
Well, see, again, are the sensations you or are you the awareness of the sensations apparently happening?
Right. I'm the awareness of the senses. Right.
Okay. And again, is there any evidence that the sensations are yours apart from a thought that says they are my sensations?
No.
None. So it is just an apparent happening in the field of awareness that you are. So Jesus says in the Course, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still as God created me. He means that literally, and you can check and see if it's true, because it's true. There is only, the only thing that holds the house of cards together is the thought that says I'm a body.
And belief in it.
But again, it's just a thought that says, I'm the body, but you don't have to believe the thought. And if you don't, you experience what you are that's not the body. So in every given moment, we're choosing to be the self that doesn't exist, as Jesus says in lesson 93, or we're choosing to be awareness. And so again, you know, thoughts are apparently happening, thinking's apparently happening, and feelings are apparently happening. And you know, what gels all that together is you normally go, they are my thoughts. They are my feelings. But you just check, are you the thoughts and feelings or are you the awareness of thoughts and feelings happening?
Awareness.
Yeah. And is there any evidence that they are your thoughts and feelings other than the thought that says they are my thoughts and feelings?
No.
So just check, is awareness thinking? Is awareness feeling? Is awareness even having this conversation? Because this conversation is apparently happening, but just check and see, are you awareness having this conversation?
I'm just the awareness. This thing's the conversation is just out there doing
the conversation
thing.
Is just what's apparently happening.
Yeah.
But you're never in the projection. So that's above the battleground. I mean, you awareness, is there any sense of limitation or boundary to what you are as awareness?
No.
And, you know, there's a story about, you know, where I've been and what I've been through and, you know, spiritual seeking and trying to learn and work things out and, you know, trying to be this holier person. And does that exist as anything in this present moment other than story?
No.
And that story, is it any more real than a dream that you've had last night in this moment?
No.
And it's always this moment. And so you, the awareness that you are here now, can you find the one those stories are about?
No.
No. There is never a separate self there. There are just happenings that have apparently happened. And if you go looking for the person they happen to, it's not there. I mean, what do you find when you look for the separate self that they're about? All you find is the present moment awareness that you are here and now. Is that your experience?
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's no separate self. Okay, it's just a self that's made out of stories. That's why Jesus keeps calling it the self that you made. It is never here in the present moment. It has to be made up out of stories in a non-existent past. And Jesus is going, but you are present moment, non-judgmental awareness right now in the holy instant. And so, Matt, the awareness that you are, is there any sense of lack or need in it?
No.
None. Ever. And is there any sense, like, is there anything to me other than your awareness of me?
No.
No. And is there any sense of where a boundary or where you end and I begin?
No.
No. And you've had a look to see if there's a separate self there. Because again, you know, Jesus says the body is never here in the present moment. That's the physical or the psychological body. So if you, again, go looking for a separate self here in this moment without recourse to a past or a future, what do you find?
It's just nothingness.
Just the awareness? Yeah, it's just the nothingness. And are you separate from the nothingness?
It's just, I'm just the awareness. The nothingness is just...
The nothingness is also, just check, in your experience, are you separate from the nothingness?
It's just in my awareness.
It is the awareness. You are the nothingness. And the only problem you ever have in life is that you think you're the somethingness. And so you've just checked and you found no evidence of a separate self in the past. You have found no evidence of a separate self in the present moment. And you've realized that you awareness don't have a personal center. There is no hero of the dream. There's nobody in the body. So now, can you check? Do I have a personal center?
No.
No, there are stories about what I might have done as a body. There could be assumptions about what's in my mind, and there could be presumptions of a future. But they're just stories, and none of them are here now in this moment. In this moment, there is just the awareness that we both are. And again, talking is apparently happening right now. But again, if you check, are you the one that's talking?
No.
No. It's just what's apparently happening. And so again, you are never in the projection. You're never in the world. You are never the separate self. You're never in the dream. This is above the battleground. Above the battleground is not in the dream. It's not in the ego mind at all. You know, the consciousness can be wrong-minded or right-minded. It can't be both, and it can't be neither. So if you identify as the self made out of stories that's never actually there in the present moment, and it's always the present moment, then you will not be able to find awareness in the Holy Spirit, okay? And if you are right-minded as consciousness, if you are identified with awareness right now in this moment, and that's what you're knowing yourself to be, which is your experience right now, you can't find the separate self. Because you see, it's one or the other. It can't be neither and it can't be both.
That's very helpful.
Yeah. So look, if you identify as the self that doesn't exist, Jesus is quite clear in lesson 93, the self you made is not the Son of God and nothing it thinks or does means anything at all. Then, you know, all that's happening is there have been happenings and they have created lack and fear and want, and they have translated into thoughts. And every time a decision has to be made, the thoughts just fight with each other and one wins. And it's utterly inevitable which thought wins. And that just leads to more thoughts and more thoughts. And then they fight with each other for a new decision. And that's the ego script, which is already written. That is completely predictable. The dominoes have already been set in motion. And it's a foregone conclusion what's going to happen. So thinking is apparently happening, deciding is apparently happening, but there's nobody thinking, there's nobody deciding. It's just what's apparently happening. And as you've seen yourself, there's no separate self there doing it. So when we identify as a separate self, what we're doing, it's like jumping into a movie and deluding yourself that I, the movie character, am deciding what's going to happen next. And I'm really making decisions for myself instead of following the movie script.
Right, I'm Indiana Jones running away from a giant boulder. Keith, this boulder's chasing me. How can you talk about this?
So ultimately, this is just what's apparently happening, but you're not in the movie, okay? You can be deluded that you are if you think you're the self that doesn't exist. Now, alternatively, you can identify as the awareness you always are here now in this moment in the Holy Spirit, and it's always this moment. And now, instead of thoughts of lack and fear and need translating themselves into thoughts and needs and lacks going forwards, now the stillness you are, the peace that you are, the wholeness that you are is going to translate itself into thinking and speaking and doing. But as you've just seen, you awareness are still not doing that. It's just what's apparently happening. That's the Holy Spirit script. And it's also already written. But you are never in the movie. You awareness are never in the movie. And so there's no separate self. There's no, as Jesus says, who is the you that are living in the world? Spirit is immortal and immortality is a constant state. And so the awareness that you are is the memory and consciousness of oneness. God and Christ is one. Christ not split up into billions of wrong minds and not separate from God. That's what awareness is. And that's why you can't find a difference between me or you. You can't find a personal center in me or you if you identify as awareness.
Wow, that's quite an exercise.
How much of the time for you would you say you are in that awareness?
Yeah, I have spent the last 2.5 years starting at 5%. And it's just slowly climbed and climbed and climbed and climbed. And I can say without exaggeration that right now it's about 75% of the time. So I am by no means constantly identifying as the stillness, the peace, the present moment awareness I am in the Holy Spirit. I am not there all the time. I can still be tempted from the stately calm, from the quiet center, from the changeless dwelling place in order to believe that I am the thinker of the ego's thoughts and the feeler of the ego's feelings and the one that the stories are about and the one that the happenings are happening to. And as soon as I do that, some kind of suffering will arise. It'll be irritation or anxiety or fear or impatience. And the minute it does, I go, oh, I was insane. Let me go back to what I am in the Holy Spirit. And that is simply a non-judgmental awareness. And it is the problem is you cannot get back there by fighting your mind. You cannot get back there by fighting your emotions, trying to fix them, trying to change them, trying to let them go. None of that will take you back to what you are as awareness. The only thing that will take you back is allowing the circus to be exactly what it is. You mustn't ever fight the darkness. It is in the allowing, the welcoming, the non-resistance, the non-judgment of the darkness that the peace rises in your mind. And then you make your stand as the peace and not the circus. And then the circus can't stand.
Oh, you know,
this brings to mind some, and I don't know why, but I kind of do. My mother talking to me about awakening. And I actually think it might have been before she got the course, but I don't know. But that was certainly consciousness and awareness and awakening and enlightenment was in her path. So she would talk about it. And I remember, I think it was about 10 or 11, questioning her saying, so what does it mean to wake up from this form of existence? And she talked and said, you know, it's a pure state of love and this isn't real. And then she said, and I said, well, is that likely to happen anytime soon? Like if you don't work on it, can it just appear to you? And she said, it's unlikely, but it's not, you know, it has happened to people to just wake up. And she said, why? And I said, I just hope it doesn't happen to me right away because I'm having too much fun. And she would remind me of that and laugh. And she'd come into my room. And I remember sitting on a radiator and looking out the window with tears coming down my eyes. And she'd say, what are you doing? And I said, I'm enjoying my depression so much.
Oh, it's a very powerful practice. Very powerful practice. Very powerful practice.
Absolutely. But there was this, it was coming from a different side of it to this, okay, here I am. How do I enjoy it here until it starts to dissolve? And my practice is different now, but they're kind of meeting some way in the middle, and I don't even know how to articulate it yet.
Yeah, you see, part of the problem is the mystique associated with awakening. Because you see, we all think the vampire awakens, but the separate self awakens, but it doesn't. It's just the realization that you're not the separate self. Like just now, live on air, Matt McCabe had an awakening. He realized that there's never been a separate self there, and he's not one now. He can fool himself if he wants to. Again, he can leave the truth of what he is as present moment awareness in the Holy Spirit. But right now, he has had an awakening. There's no mistake about it. It is the most intimate experience of what we've always been. Jesus says, enlightenment is but a recognition. It's not a change at all. So, I mean, again, Matt, is there or is there not in your experience, just the experience that you've always been this, but it was you just weren't looking at it?
Right, exactly.
Okay, so you know, it's just a recognition. It's the most ordinary thing in the world. And after, you know, before awakening, chop wood, carry water. After awakening, chop wood, carry water. Awakening is not the end of the journey. It's the beginning of the journey. Because now it is about the embodying. It is about the translation of the peace of the awareness that you are, the complete lack of needs there, the complete lack of want. And it's about that translating itself into thoughts, into thinking and doings and speakings, that's just going to be what apparently happens in the dream. And it's really just now being vigilant for the ways that you can be pulled from the truth of what you are to identify as the self you made that doesn't exist, as Jesus says.
Yeah.
So awakening is the beginning, and now comes the embodying of that, the extension of that into all the speakings and the thinkings and the doings. And like I say, some of them will happen really naturally and really easily, and they'll just be right-minded thinking and doing and just doing what is most helpful and loving and effective for everyone concerned with a situation. It will happen very easy. But other situations will drag you apparently from the truth of what you are to get sort of tied up in stories and start drowning in the ego stories, thoughts and feelings again. But at any given moment, as soon as you notice yourself suffering, you just go back to the stately camp. You just go back to the changeless dwelling place. And the darkness can't stand. The upset can't stand. It was only ever there because you thought you were something you're not. So that's the journey from here. So awakening is the beginning. And then it's just learning to embody that always, so that nothing can take you from identification with this wholeness, with this peace that you are in the Holy Spirit, and seeing that as the truth in everyone, no matter what the appearances are saying. The appearances don't mean anything, as Jesus tells us in the first workbook lesson. It doesn't mean anything at all. You've given it all the meaning it has for you. This love appearing as something that means nothing at all, you have now projected a meaning onto that, which is all about what you think about yourself as an ego and nothing to do with the love that's only apparently appearing as something that means nothing. So ultimately, that would be Christ's vision. I think this is the most beautiful description in the course of Christ's vision. It says, I thank you, Father, knowing you will come to close each little gap that lies between the broken pieces of your Holy Son. Your holiness, complete and perfect, lies in every one of them. And they are joined because what is in one is in them all. How holy is the smallest grain of sand when it is recognized as being part of the completed picture of God's Son. The forms, the broken pieces seem to take me nothing, for the whole is in each one, and every aspect of the Son of God is just the same as every other part. So again, in your experience, Matt, the awareness that you are is the truth of what I am, what Tam is, what the world is, and everything else is just awareness appearing as something that it's not. And it doesn't matter because it's just an appearance, because there is just the holiness. There is just the oneness. There is just the peace. Again, the forms don't matter. Is it an old person or a young person? Is it a man? Is it a woman? Is it a sick person? Is it a dying person? Is it a dead person? The forms, the broken pieces seem to take me nothing, because the holiness, the wholeness of Christ is the truth of all the apparent appearances that mean nothing at all. Everything is holiness. Again, when you want only love, that's all you'll see. The appearances mean nothing. All there is to them is the love.
Thank you for showing us what you do, what we all are invited to do in real time.
Yeah.
If this is real time. And thank you for the Halloween analogy. Really, really love it.
Yeah, that was beautiful, Keith. I didn't know we were going to have a session here, but I'm glad we did.
Yeah, you see, the beauty of the awakening is if you ever suffer again, you can't lie to yourself and go, I'm an innocent victim. Because the only problem is that you think you're a self that doesn't exist, that's made out of stories. You're not acknowledging that there's only ever present moment awareness to what you are in the Holy Spirit.
You know, this is giving me a whole new idea, Matt, for podcasts where we have people come on the second time and give us sessions. So that we can awaken even faster, even though there's no time, within all of our guests and amongst. Love it.
Well, Keith, this has been beautiful. I thank you. Why don't you tell listeners how they can get in touch with you and all the things you've going on, your coaching practice, the Facebook group, all those things.
Yeah, we're doing that even before he tells us about his keto diet. And
I was gonna save a replacement question instead of his comfort food for the very last thing.
okay, good. As long as we do that.
Fair enough. So the Facebook group is called A Course in Miracles with Keith. And do please agree to the group rules before at the time of application so you can be admitted. The podcast is called A Course in Miracles with Keith. The website is www.acimwithkeith.com. And you can find out about things like private paid coaching with myself there on the website as well.
Wonderful.
You can catch us on YouTube. We have like, I don't know, we have like almost 2 years of meetings there on YouTube you can check out. So that's also A Course in Miracles with Keith.
Now, Keith, in light of you, we already know your comfort food is pasta. So here's a question for you. What is your favorite emoji to use in text messages?
Oh, wow. I think it's the one that has the eyes bulging out in surprise. That might be one of my most used emojis. My favorite one as well. It always makes me laugh.
Yeah.
Oh, I have a little piece of trivia.
What's that?
You know the two hands together that looks like they're in prayer that I use all the time for thank you?
Yeah, apparently it's a high five.
It's a high five. Originally.
It can definitely serve as both, though. It can definitely serve as both.
I didn't know that was a high five. It's too symmetrical for a high five. Who high fives like that?
Yep.
Well, Keith, thanks so much for coming on Miracle Voices and sharing your Miracle
Voice
again.
Thanks for having me back.
And we look forward to having you sometime in the future.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for listening today. Please subscribe to Miracle Voices by hitting the subscribe button on your podcast app. If you are enjoying these conversations, please consider leaving us a review on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or whatever podcast app you use. And lastly, please visit us at miraclevoices.org and join our newsletter so we can stay connected. Until the next podcast, I want to leave you with my favorite course quote, "When you want only love, you will see nothing else."